Church family, thank you for just taking the time to do that. Just thank you. Let's commit to be praying over these next few weeks as Agnes is there for treatment and not forget that our prayers do matter and they do make a difference. I want to share with you this morning, if possible, one of my favorite things about being a parent. Now look, parenting has its up days and it has its down days, all right? But one of my favorite things is seeing something through the eyes of my children that I just haven't seen before, or maybe seeing something that either I've long since taken for granted, all right, or I've long since kind of been jaded by. Kids are just great in rediscovering the world through their eyes. Over the past few months of summer, one of those things that has kind of reawakened inside of me is the magic of a birthday invitation. Now look, usually when birthday invitations come to my house, I kind of like inwardly groan as the grumpy old man that I am, because it's just one more thing to add on the calendar. All right, Russell's shaking his head, he knows. It's just one more thing you gotta go shopping for. It's just one more place I gotta go and either be like one of the only dudes who showed up, or I gotta drop my children off and leave them. So inwardly, I just go, ugh. However, for my kids, a birthday invitation is like a treasure, right? I mean, it is like the magical key to a world full of friends and fun and cake. It's awesome. And especially with Ruby, like at the age of 5 right now, like usually what happens when Ruby gets a birthday invitation is it's carried all the way around the house and like shown to you right as close to your face as it can get. Then it's posted up on the refrigerator in which a countdown begins to ensue, which every day the frequency and the volume of the announcements about how excited I am for the birthday party until the party is finally over. There is power in an invitation. And sometimes I forget that, but my kids have reawakened that in me this summer, and there really is power in something as simple as an invitation. Over this past month, we've been going back to basics, and if you've been around, we've been talking about why we do what we do here at Starkville Community Church. We started that process out by talking about the power of our mission. In fact, talking about the fact that the power that we need as believers is the power of the Holy Spirit inside of us. And if we want that same power that we see in Scripture, the same power that healed people and released them from prison, same power that saved them and that built churches, that the only path to that power is prayer. It's part of why we're praying the way we are for Agnes, because we want to access that power and ask God to use it. But we also talked about the fact that every purpose needs that power, that we can't do anything as a church without it. And then over the last 2 weeks, we kind of started talking about our process, right? We said that our job and our mission at our church is to make disciples. And we said that to do that, we really believe that we need to proclaim gospel truth, we need to pursue gospel community, and we need to practice gospel mission. And we talked about the fact that the best way to teach people what it means to follow Jesus is making sure that in everything we do as a church, that we are proclaiming the truth of Jesus Christ, and that everything we are as a church is built around a true community that only God can bring and bind together. That's how we start accomplishing this purpose. Well, I want to wrap up today, and I want to wrap up mainly by talking about what does it mean to truly practice gospel mission. So I want you to turn to Psalm 34. Psalm 34, and we're going to read this together this morning and then dig into what it means. This is what Scripture says. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Verse 11, come, O children, and listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous and his ears toward their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. He keeps all his bones, not one of them is broken. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned, but the Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. Pray with me. Father, I thank you so much for your word, and I thank you for just the power that it holds, the joy that it brings. And so I pray this morning that you would let every part of me wash away, and God, that you would help us to see in your word what it is you desire to teach us. And God, I pray that you might continue to build us as a church, not based on a preacher, not based on programs, but God, based on the very spirit of you. So Lord, thank you for drawing us together through the gospel of Jesus today. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Look, Psalm 34 is another wilderness psalm. Now, back during the summer, we had a chance to kind of start going through some of the psalms that David wrote when he was in the wilderness fleeing at different times of his life. And this is another one of those. In fact, this one was written as he is fleeing from Saul. Saul is trying to take his life, and David is trying to run as fast and as far away as possible. Some of you, if you have your Bibles, will see an inscription at the top of Psalm 34. For some of you, it may say that it was written when David fled from the presence of Ahimelech, all right, in Gath. For some of you, it may say a psalm of David while he was in the cave at Adullam. Well, the whole story of this is that David is running from Saul. In fact, he's so desperate that he literally steals the bread from the tabernacle of God and then runs to the Philistine city of Gath, which is the hometown of Goliath. Yeah, that was not a smart move, man. All right, but that's the only, like, David's so scared, that's the only place he knows to go. So he shows up in Gath. He literally acts like he's crazy so that they won't think he's a threat, and then realizes that this was not a good idea to come here. And so it says that David then leaves Gath, and the story is told in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 22. This is what it says, that David departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brothers and all of his father's house heard it, they went down there to him. Verse 2, and everyone who was in distress, and everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was bitter in soul gathered to him. And he became commander over them. And there were there with him about 400 men. Now I want to read you a couple other translations of verse 2. The Holman Christian puts it this way. In addition, every man who was desperate, in debt, or discontented rallied around him. And he became their leader. The Message puts it this way, that not only that, but all who were down on their luck came around. Losers and vagrants and misfits of all sorts. And David became their leader. Now look, this is not the group, if you're a future king, that you want to start off a kingdom with, all right? With vagrants and homeless people and criminals and people who were in debt, so they don't have any money. Like, they're not going to be given to you. They're not going to buy you anything. All right, this is not the group that's going to inspire other people to come around and to build a kingdom around. Yet, this is the group that David finds himself surrounded by. A group that is diverse as any other. A group that is not only diverse, but literally is desperate. And what I love is that David's response is to sing. And maybe that's why David's one of my favorite characters in the Bible, because in every moment, there's a reason for David to sing. But he doesn't just sing. He doesn't just praise. Psalm 34 is what we call an invitational psalm. David sings the psalm and writes it in order to not only give his own response to God, but to invite all of those who were with him to respond to the same God that he was responding to. I want to say that again, because that's going to be the basis of this entire morning. David sings Psalm 34 not only to respond to God, but to invite all those around him to respond to God as well. And what I love is that David shows us in that in any moment, in any circumstance, with any group of people, that we can fulfill the mission to make disciples. We can fulfill the mission to call people to God through the power of a simple invitation. So if you're here this morning and you hear us talk about missions, and in your mind you start thinking about the words like evangelism and the idea of sharing your faith, and that scares the death out of you, all right? Like, that just makes you nervous on the inside, then what I want you to hear is that this morning is for you. Because David gives four invitations that I think are as applicable for us today as they were when he was back in that cave in Adullam. So I want us to look at what those four invitations are. Look at verses 1 through 3. David says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Verse 3, oh, magnify the Lord with me, he says, and let us exalt his name together. David didn't know these people. The only ones he knew were his family members. And just honestly, if you remember the story of Goliath, they didn't like David that much, and he didn't like them that much. He didn't have the best relationship with his family members. All right, but everybody else, David doesn't know them. He doesn't know their backgrounds. He doesn't know their stories. He doesn't know their theological stances. And yet David says, praise the Lord with me. He invites them to praise God with him. And that's the first invitation I want us to realize. As church, if we want to practice mission, it's not complicated. Simply invite people to praise God with you, because the application is that anyone can praise. It literally is the best common ground we have. It's why Paul writes in the book of Romans in chapter 1 that nobody has an excuse to stand before God and say, I didn't know about you. I didn't know that there was a God that I was going to have to answer to, because Paul says all of creation testifies to who he is. He says it doesn't matter if they grew up in church or not. They look at the world around them and they see a God who is powerful and a God who is big, and there is no excuse. And because of that, church family, I would tell you that the greatest thing that we can do is invite everyone around us to praise God with us. Anyone can praise. And so we need to call our friends and our neighbors and our coworkers to respond and recognize who God is and that he is active in the world around them. Now, here's the second application for that for us. And this is the one that's going to hit some of us, especially guys, those of us who are men in this room. It's going to hit us a little harder, and this is why. Don't be private with your praise. Okay? David could have gone in that cave, and man, he could have just sulked. He could have gone in that cave, and he could have just had some time to recoup by himself. Man, he could have had his own little worship service with God and done his deal. But what David does is he stands before the group that rallies around him, and he says, come and praise the Lord with me. He says, let us exalt his name together. And what that tells me is that we should not be private with our praise. Everyone around us should hear us continually praising God. That's what David says. He says, I will continually praise him with my lips. Now, look, that doesn't mean we have to go around singing all the time. All right? I actually do go around singing all the time, but it's because I'm a music nerd, okay? So, like, that's just why I'm, like, messed up inside. But you don't have to do that. Just go around and be nice. And tell people why you love being you. Tell people why you love this world around us. Tell people why you love each day that God has given you. Give him glory for that. She's not here this morning, so I'm going to use her as an example, since she's not. And you can tell her on me later. But Angela Baker is in our dinner group that we've been meeting with this summer. And if you don't know Angela, she's a widow here in our church, and she works for Mississippi State. But Angela is literally involved in everything that happens in Starkville. All right? Like, I'm not exaggerating. If it's going on in this town, I swear to you and promise you, Angela Baker is a part of it. And what I love about that is Angela is around more lost people than I can even imagine. All right? I mean, she's constantly around people who do not know Jesus. And Angela, every time I hear words out of her mouth, every time I see her, she is always positive and thanking God for the day that she has. She's thanking God for the weather, and she's thanking God for being at church, and she's thanking God for getting her up. And look, it is a testimony to all those who don't know Jesus that Angela's around, because Angela's life is a life of public praise to God. And if we want to invite people to know the same God that we do, it can't come out of left field. It can't be a secret. It's got to be open. And then we can invite them to praise God with us. That's not the only invitation David gives, though. Look at verses 4 through 8. David invites them to praise God, but he also invites them to experience God. He says, I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears.
Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear and deliver them. Verse 8, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. David spends verses 4 through 7 talking about how God has been good to him. And I love that David does that because David isn't out of the woods yet. Saul is still trying to kill him. In fact, he's 15 years away at this point from even being anointed king over Israel. Yet David says, God's been so good to me. And he says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Notice that David says, he doesn't say, hey, listen to how the Lord has been good to me. He kind of assumes that. But he says, taste and see. He uses two sensory, experiential words to say, look, don't just listen to how good God has been. Come and taste it. Come and see it. Come and experience the goodness of God for yourself. Because he hasn't been just good to me. He's good to everybody. And what that tells me is that experience leads to evangelism. Do you want to not be scared to death to evangelize? Do you want to not be nervous about sharing your faith? Let me tell you the secret. Just talk about what God's done for you. Just talk about who he is in your life. Talk about your experience and then tie that experience to the gospel of Jesus and say, look, you can know that same God that met me, the same God that rescued me, the same God that freed me, the same God that healed me, the same God that mended my marriage. You can know him, you can experience him and share with them how. That's it. It's not complicated. Our experience should lead to evangelism. How much more effective would that be, church family, if our evangelism came out of what God has done in our lives and it didn't come out of just handing somebody a track or a pre-learned program of what we're supposed to say? Some of you have heard me talk about my X plus one strategy that I learned from a seminary professor at Southeastern Seminary. I want to kind of just run this by you again, because if we talk about inviting people to experience God, it's literally this simple. Your life is one line. So I want you to think about one line of an X. Everywhere you go, everything you do, everywhere you live, your line is one side. Everybody that you meet in your life is also living a line, a journey that they're on. The moment that those journeys intersect, at that point, our goal is to get them one step closer to Jesus. So somebody that you're in class with, college students, God has very purposely intersected your life with them in that moment. So look, it may be presenting the gospel. It may be asking them how to pray with them. It may just be getting to know them and being a friendly face. But your job is in that class, in that moment, to get them one step closer to Jesus. When we go to lunch after church today, your job is to not be snarky with the waiter or waitress, all right, that's serving you. It's not to complain about how long it may take. You know what your job is? God has put that waiter or waitress to intersect your family and your life today, right in that moment. So get them one step closer to Jesus. If we started looking at every intersection of our life with somebody else as a chance to do that, how would it change us as a church? How would it change our city? How would it change our schools and our workplaces? How would it change our families? If we realize that every moment I'm with my kids, every moment I spend with my wife, maybe every moment you spend with a brother or sister that you don't get along with, is an opportunity for you to bring them one step closer to Jesus. We don't have to fix anybody. We don't have to save anybody. Just get them a step closer to Jesus. And if we keep doing that, I promise you, they'll experience him. They'll come to praise him, and they'll come to know who he is. Invite them to praise God with you. Invite them to experience God with you. Third, invite them to believe in God with you. Look at verses 9 and 10. David says, oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Now look, this idea of fearing God and this idea of seeking God, of having reverence for him, all right, and going after him, it only happens if you believe that God is who he says he is. If you've got questions about whether or not he's a good God or a loving God or an honest God or an eternal God, you do not fear him. There's no reason to. But if he is,
who he says he is, then there's every reason to fear him. There's every reason to hold reverence for him. There's every reason to seek after the things that he has. And so this is what it tells me, is that David is inviting this group, this desperate and discontented group, to believe who God is with him. And we need to not only invite people to join us in praising God and in experiencing God, but we also need to invite them in believing in who he is. Not who we say he is, but who he is. And church family, we can't do that apart from his word. And what I love about that is that when we believe in who the word of God says that God is, you know what happens? Our worship overcomes our worry. Our praise overcomes our pain. And no matter what we're facing in life, we're able to say, I know who God is. And I believe it, and I trust it, and I fear him, and I will seek after him no matter what. This is what David's living. He's in the middle of a cave, surrounded by people he doesn't know, far away from the promise, far away from all of the celebrations and praise of who he is as a warrior. He has lost everything. You can't tell me that the thought didn't enter into David's mind in the middle of that cave of, what am I doing here? I'm supposed to be king. What am I doing in this spot, in this moment, with these people? But David doesn't. What David chooses is he chooses to believe in who God says he is and what God says he will do. And some of you are here this morning and you're looking around at your life and you're saying, God, I don't know. How did I get up here? How did I end up in this spot and in this place and in this time? This doesn't make sense. This doesn't seem like what you promised me. And this is what I would say to you. Right now is when you need to choose to believe. Because he is who he says he is. And he will do what he says that he will do. I can't prove that to you other than to show you over and over again in my life where that's been true. We need to invite people to praise God with us. We need to invite them to experience God with us. But we also need to invite them to believe in God with us, that there is a God that is bigger than them, their circumstance, that there is a God that's bigger than the trouble they're facing. Church family, our world needs that. Our city needs that. Our campus desperately, desperately needs that. God is bigger than the addictions I face. He's bigger than the pills I'm popping to make it through class or work. He's bigger than my family falling apart. He's bigger than my marriage that isn't anything of what I thought it would be. He's bigger than my child or my loved one being sick. He is bigger than all those things. And when we're tempted to give up and when we're tempted to despair, that's when we need to choose to believe. Finally, we need to invite them to follow God. Look at verses 11 to 14. Because they give us a lesson in what it means to believe. David says this, "Come, O children, come, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days that he may see good?" The answer is all of us, all right, desire life and to see good. Verse 13, he says, "Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it." David says, look, if you want to know how to fear God, how to trust him, how to believe in him, then you have to follow him. Do you see what David says? He says, let me teach you the way. Turn from evil and do good. The problem is that we want to follow Jesus without doing anything. We want to follow Jesus by feeling good, right? It's what we hear all around us. It's what we live. Hey, I'm all about Jesus. I'm all about faith. I think this is a good thing to know, a good thing to hear. But the problem is that once we start realizing that Jesus wants us to turn from evil and to do good, to give up some of the things that we don't want to give up, to stop doing some of the things that we really enjoy doing, to make some decisions that we don't want to make, then it gets hard. And here's what I want you to remember. If you don't remember anything else this morning, this is it. Faith means following. It doesn't mean feeling good. Faith means following. It means turning from what we're supposed to turn from and doing the right thing and seeking peace. From the very beginning, in fact, in the very beginning, when God is setting up the covenant with the Israelites, he says this in Deuteronomy 11, verse 1. You shall therefore love the Lord your God and keep his charge and his statutes, his rules and his commandments always. Do you see? Do you see how he tied that? He says, you shall love the Lord your God and do what? Keep his commandments. In 1 John, the apostle writes this in chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. He says, and by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar. Do you hear that? And the truth is not in him. Verse 5, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. Jesus himself in Luke 28 put it this way. He said, blessed, or more than happy rather, are those who hear the word of God and do what? Keep it. In John chapter 14, verses 15 and 21, he says that if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Then in the next chapter in John 15, Jesus says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. And he compares it to this. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. To have faith means that we follow. We cannot love God and not obey him. We cannot love God and not follow his commandments. We don't do it because we have to. And I want to make sure that you understand that for me. We don't do it because it's a list of rules and regulations that we have to maintain and we have to keep. That's what the Israelites lived with. That was their whole system of faith. That I have to live by all of these rules and all these things. And when I don't, then I have to make the exact right sacrifice at the right time, in the right amount, in order for God to be okay with me. And when Jesus came, he said, none of that will work. None of that is doing what you really need, which is a transformation of your heart, so that from now on, you'll look at these rules and you'll look at these commandments and you'll want to follow them because you love me. He says, if you follow my commandments, you'll abide in my love. We got to follow. Faith means following. And we need to make sure, church family, that when we're inviting our lost family members and neighbors and coworkers and friends to come to Jesus, that we are sharing the whole gospel with them. That we're sharing that Jesus loves them, but that they're going to have to give some things up. And they're going to have to be changed by him. Because faith means following. It doesn't mean feeling good. It means to follow. In 1854, Edward Kimball was serving as a youth Sunday school teacher at Mount Vernon Congregational Church in Boston when the pastor of the church brought in a young 17-year-old man to his class. This young man had no interest in God or religion, but he was there every week. And so Kimball resolved that he must invite this young man to follow Jesus. So one afternoon, he started down to the shoe store where the young man worked. Edward Kimball later wrote in his diary that when I was nearly there, I began to wonder whether I ought to go just then, during business hours. And I thought maybe my mission might embarrass the boy. That when I went away, the other clerks might ask who I was, and when they learned, might taunt him. Still, Kimball determined to speak to the young man, and he found him in the back of the store, wrapping up shoes. The Sunday school teacher told the young man of Christ's love for him and the love that Jesus wanted in return. And there in the back of Holton's shoe store, the young man accepted Jesus as his Savior and as his Lord. That young man was D.L. Moody, a man who became an evangelist that shared the gospel of Christ with more than 100 million people across the world. But that's not the end of the story. You see, because of Kimball's invitation, D.L. Moody came to Christ. And through the subsequent ministry of D.L. Moody, a pastor in London named F.B. Meyer came to Jesus. Then through the invitation of F.B. Meyer, J. Wilbur Chapman began to follow Christ. And through the invitation of Chapman, an evangelist named Billy Sunday came to Jesus. Billy Sunday was integral in sharing the gospel with a man named Mordecai Ham. And Mordecai Ham was the preacher who invited a young man named Billy Graham to devote his life to Jesus. Edward Kimball's story shows us the power of one invitation, the power of inviting one single person to know Jesus. We don't know what God may do with it. We don't know the lives that may be changed. We don't know the families that may be impacted. Our job isn't to know. Our job isn't to choose. Our job is to just invite. Come praise the same God that I do. Come experience the same God that I've experienced. Come believe in the same God that I've believed in. Come follow the same Jesus that I follow. So here's my question this morning. Who do you need to invite? Is it a friend? Is it a family member? Is it a coworker? Is it a classmate? Is it a neighbor? Who do you need to invite? A few years ago, Lifeway did a study when they asked people, what brought you to church? 6 to 8% said that they walked in by their own initiative. They just woke up, decided that today is the day I'm going to church, and they went. 2 to 3% showed up because of a program, whether children or youth or music, whatever. 8 to 10% came because they liked the pastor. That percentage seems high, if you ask me, all right? There's always one, you know? 3 to 4% came because they had a physical need that was met by the church. Another 3 to 4% came because they were attracted by a small group or invited by a small group. 1 to 2%, hear that, 1 to 2% came because they were evangelized by a stranger. 70 to 85%. You know why they came? Because they were invited by a relative or a friend. 70 to 85% of people say, I'm here because someone who loved me, someone who knew me, invited me. So who do we need to invite? Because God has put so many people in our path. So many people that need to know the love of Jesus. So many people that need to experience the grace and mercy that we've experienced. So many people that need to believe that God can do what He says He's going to do and that He is who He says He is. So who do you need to invite? I want you to look at that card that you got when you came in. On the back of it, it says, a box that says, look, my next step today is. And all through this series, you've heard me say that all of us have a next step. For you, you may be here and you may say, Joe, somebody invited me today and I need to know Jesus. I'm like D.L. Moody. And man, I may be here at church, but I do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I've never said, Jesus, I'm a sinner and I cannot make myself right with God. And you may say, Joe, I want to know how to do that. I want to know what it means to be a follower of Jesus. If you check that box, I promise you, we will get together and talk about what does it mean to truly follow Jesus. For some of you, you may be here, you may say, Joe, I know that I'm supposed to be a part of this fellowship in this time. And if you check, we will get you connected with a smaller group of believers. But for all of us, I hope you've heard this morning. Every single one of us ought to have somebody that we need to invite. Somebody that we need to say, hey, come and experience and praise and believe and follow with me. Let's do this together. And so here's what I ask you to do. Regardless of what other next step you may have today, I want you to take a look at the line that says, invite a friend, coworker, neighbor to church. And then underneath that is a box that says, please pray for this person. And I'm going to ask you to write a name on that line. A name of someone, look, you may not have said a word to them about Jesus, but you may know, look, I keep coming across them every single day. I know I'm going to see them this next week, and I want to help them get one step closer to Jesus. I want to invite them. And if you'll put a name on that line, I promise you, I will pray for that person's name every single day. And I will pray for you every single day. That God would just work through you to invite that person to come to know Jesus. To invite that person to praise with you and to follow with you and to believe with you. So what we're going to do is this. We're going to bow our heads and we're going to pray. And then in a minute, as we pass the offering plates around, we're going to just simply ask you to put these cards in that offering plate. And if you need to talk after this service about what it means to follow Jesus, or if you've got a specific prayer request, I'm going to be right here, right up front. And I would love to talk with you and to pray with you. But church family, the question is, will we choose to walk it out this week? And will we choose to invite, or will we just go on with blinders on, blind to those around us? So pray. What name does God want you to write down? Would you bow your heads with me?